G'day mate, welcome to another Oxygen Not Included tutorial with me, Jetty. So, today I want to cover bathrooms, and the main reason I really want to cover the bathrooms is bathrooms are a byproduct of having duplicates, but they have a couple of waste products and we really want to find a use for them. So, we need to go through some basics first. So, we have our basic bathroom. As we can see here, we've had Marie, Nails and Ren, and Ren again happily come use this bathroom to show us off how it works. So, each one of them comes in here, they use our outhouses. Now, our outhouses are, and our wash basins are our very, very first early tech. We get to help our duplicates relieve themselves, and basically, they relieve themselves in a pile of dirt at the bottom of these outhouses. After 15 uses, another duplicate needs to come along and clean out the outhouse, I'll put it that way. And then the outhouse is ready to be used by another be used another 15 times by duplicates. At the same time, we have our wash basins. Our wash basins require a lot of manual labor. They require not only a duplicate to come and deliver clean water into the wash basin, but also after each use of the wash basin, we end up with this polluted water that a duplicate needs to take away. Now, you do get a room bonus from having a latrine. So latrine is some sort of toilet and some sort of wash basin. The upgraded to that version of that is the washroom. Now, the washroom is what we have down here, and we're just going to stop the duplicates accessing that room and have them come access this room instead. And I have 40 duplicates that are dying to pee out there somewhere. So, Leary is going to come and use this bathroom and show us off how this one works. Now, this one is all completely plumbed, but it's set up with a self-recycling water system. So, if we look at our plumbing section here, we have the lavatory, number one, and our upgrade from our wash basin is a sink. Now, we're going to cover the sink first because that's the easy one. It takes in 5 kilos of water per use and gives us back 5 kilos of polluted water per use. We need to find something to do with that polluted water. We'll cover that in a sec. As for the lavatory itself, it again takes in 5 kilos of clean water per use, but it actually outputs 11.7 kilograms per use. Of that, 5 kilos is the clean water it already took in, and it also outputs another 6.7 kilos of duplicate waste, and we'll just leave it at that. Now, that 6.7 kilos that comes out is emitted at 37 degrees Celsius. So if you have this in your base, this will start to warm up your base to around about the 30 to 40 degree temperature. Just because the duplicate waste is going into the system at 37 degrees. Now, as you can see from the plumbing system here, it's fairly self-explanatory. We have all the sinks on the right, we have all the lavatories on the left, we've got the clean water coming in at the bottom, and then for the output pipes, basically I'm just giving myself a couple of clear squares because liquids don't always merge correctly on a output pipe. So the input pipes, every one of these has its own internal buffer of 5 kilos, i.e. one use, and it can always draw off that input pipe without a problem. On the output pipes, if Lyra, there we go, we'll slow it back down, and we look at the output. Come on, if the output from this machine covers the output for this machine, it's going to render that lavatory out of order because it has no way to output. Even if that pipe section is going to be cleared in just a couple of seconds, it doesn't matter. The game doesn't care. It's going to give you an error right there and then. So what I've actually done is I've just given myself, it's just like three extra chunks before I've joined it into the main sewer line through the roof. Yes, in Oxygen Not Included, we run the sewer lines through the roof because we're smart like that, and then brought it back down here. Now, down here, I have a water sieve. So, water sieve is under refinement right here, and it takes in 5 kilos of clean water and outputs 5 kilos of, it takes in 5 kilos of polluted water and outputs 5 kilos of clean water. It also does take in, some sand, so we need a filtration medium, so we need 1 gram per second, 1 kilogram per second of filtration medium. It's normally sand, or if you dig all the way to space, you can use regolith. It's not something you're generally going to run out of on most maps, as long as you don't just abuse it and use too much of it. And like I said, if you really want, there's plenty out in space and it falls from the sky every single meteorite strike. So, not something you're going to run out of, and we can whack one of these down, hooked up to the polluted water on the intake, and we're going to take the clean water and we're going to recycle it straight back through the same system. Yes, the duplicates are quite happily washing their hands with pee water. It is clean now. It may have some germs, so that's something that the system doesn't do. Obviously, when a duplicate uses this system, germ overlay for liquid pipes, which doesn't work terribly well. There we go. We have 85,000 germs in that one little chunk of polluted water. It does not clean the germs out of the system. So there we go. I got 56,000 germs of it is clean water. Can I click on it? No. So you got to go to the germ overlay and then hover your mouse over it. So I do have 56,000 germs in that single tile of water. They are dying off because they are in clean water. As you can see, the number is going down. So the number is going down ever so slowly. The germs will die off ever so slowly. Obviously, each time a duplicate uses the system again, it's going to reintroduce more germs to it. So it's basically going to be germy clean water forever. I normally refer to this as grey water. But it honestly, it's perfectly fine as a system. As long as you don't eat, as long as you don't cook food with water that has germs in it, you're perfectly fine. Now, back to our water sieve. So our water sieve is just taking the water and turning it from polluted water back into clean water so we can recycle it back through the system. But the one thing I have down here is I have a liquid reservoir. So liquid reservoir is just where we want to store our excess germs. And what I've actually done with the output pipes is the output from our water sieve, I've used liquid bridge. I'm going to do a follow-up video at some stage covering just how the liquid pipes and the gas pipes work, because they can be a little bit complicated. But for right here, right now, the only thing you guys need to know is when it comes to liquid pipes, they really like the white ones, and they're going to jump from a white one any chance they get and bridge off a main system. Unfortunately, the green one's the exact opposite. So they... No, let's forget that for the moment. They like jumping into the white ones first. So when the water comes up here, it's going to bridge across this connection here, and it's going to go this way first. After this pipe is backed up, i.e. this pipe's backed up, all the toilets are backed up, all the sinks are backed up, the excess water can't go this way anymore, so it's then going to flow this way into this water tank. So in this water tank, I've already got 300 kilograms of... This is clean water that I've generated. It didn't come from anywhere. As you can see, there's no input pipe into this system. Once you get water into this system, you fill up this bottom side right here with clean water. That's it. It's set to go. It's primed. It will then run forever. This is 300 kilos. So it's what? 50 uses. About 50 uses of duplicates using the system has generated this amount of water. And yes, there is a lot of germs in there. If we click on the germ overlay, we can see they are dying in clean water, and this number is going to slowly go down. Over about 50 cycles, if we weren't adding more germs to this, they would eventually die off. So yeah, that's a very, very basic toilet system, which you might already know about. You might have already seen a video on it. You might be here for this, you might not. But what I want to do is I want to take this idea and upgrade it. I'd really like some oxygen. We've got lots and lots of different ways to make oxygen, but the one I really, really like is making oxygen from my pee. So we're gonna lock that door. We're gonna let the duplicates into this room now. We're gonna invite somebody in to use the bathroom. There we go. So we've got Camille in here using the bathroom. And as you can see, between this system and this system, not a lot has changed. I've just added a few more buildings down here. So what we actually have down here is on our oxygen, we have an electrolyzer. So an electrolyzer turns water into oxygen and hydrogen. Okay, sounds simple enough. We're going to make some oxygen and some hydrogen out of our pee water. Best thing about that is this water tank, which you remember, the one above, has 300 kilograms worth of water that we can't cook with. We could grow food with it, but we can't actually cook with it. This is now turning that water into clean oxygen for us. So what we actually have here is, come on, Camille, use that system. Certain amount of that water is going to go back in to reprime this system. Five kilos, 7 kilos. Everybody wants to use the bathroom all at the same time. I do have 40 duplicates. There we go. So we've got some water coming over here. It's going to go into that same liquid reservoir before, and it's actually going to kick this electrolyzer into action. And if I pause at the right second, there we go. So we're using a certain amount of water, we're emitting a certain amount of oxygen, and we're emitting a certain amount of hydrogen with a little bit of heat. It does make heat as a byproduct. If we go down to the electrolyzer down here, it is going to output that oxygen and the hydrogen at 70 degrees Celsius. So this is our first real easy setup, and all we're going to do is we're going to take that oxygen. We're going to let oxygen, being the heavier gas, flow out the bottom. The hydrogen, if I go to my gas overlay, the hydrogen, being the lighter gas, will generally flow up the top over to here. What I actually have over here, where's that overlay? So what I have over here is I have sort of like a hydrogen trap up here. So the hydrogen has nowhere to go but up here and then down to fill up this section. This was originally filled with oxygen. When I built it with a couple of doors, all I did was run the pump for a little while until I sort of pulled all the hydrogen into this gap. Because of the way oxygen not included works, and only one gas or liquid can occupy one tile at a time. Once this is all full of hydrogen, the system's primed and ready to go. So from my gas pump, I've just got this big snake of pipes over here to a hydrogen generator and a little battery, which is going to go back and power our water sieve. And basically what I have here is above 400 grams. Basically what I have here is I have really a self-powering system. So we're going to take that hydrogen, we're going to run it into our hydrogen generator, into our battery. As you can see, the whole system's without power. Somebody made a mess, good. We're going to add some power back to the system. This water sieve's going to start running again. We're going to start putting clean water back into the system. We're going to take that excess water, turn it back into hydrogen. And as you can see, this loop's running now. As long as I'm sort of a little bit careful about what this pressure sensor's set up to. So that pressure sensor is just a little bit of automation down to this pump. And I want to set it roughly like a couple of hundred grams lower than the oxygen in your base. Every base is going to be slightly different, so it is something you need to keep in mind. And on top of that, the way this system is set up, any excess hydrogen we make is going to be run into the hydrogen generator, run into the batteries, and if the batteries are full, is going to be wasted. So this is something you really want to hook up to your main power grid and have it sort of supplement the power on the main power grid. Maybe have the duplicates run on the wheels slightly best because you're using their P to give you oxygen and free power via your hydrogen generator. What I have down here is, hang on, we just need to block their access to that bathroom and give them access to the bigger, better, and slightly improved bathroom. Is I have pretty much the exact same pipe setup as before. So here we had polluted water, clean water, sieve, along to our electrolyzer. Down here, I've just been a little bit more smart about how we're running our pipes. So this is sort of like our fourth iteration of the same build. As you'll notice, every single one of these is built in pretty much the same footprint. So as you get more technology through the technology tree, you can actually upgrade from the first one to the second one to the third one and then finally to this fourth one. Maybe you even have a better idea for a fifth version. Anyway, on our oxygen, our electrolyzer has a couple of flaws. So any oxygen and hydrogen it puts out of the system is going to be 70 degrees or hotter. So not only is the duplicate's P going to slowly heat this area up to around about 40 degrees Celsius, on top of that, this electrolyzer is also going to heat its surrounding area up to around about 70 degrees Celsius. So we want to do a few things we can, whatever we can, to mitigate that heat. So what I've actually done is electrolyzer here, it's going to output at 70 degrees or hotter if the materials are hotter. So that water that I'm currently pumping in, which should be around about like that 37 degrees Celsius temperature, because I'm always adding the same water back to the system, I'm going to come up to that like 37 degrees medium temperature. And it's probably not going to shift from there too much. It might go up a little bit, it might go down a little bit. But bottom line is, I'm going to have about 37 degrees Celsius temperature water running through this system forever. What I've actually done is I've taken the water out of here and I'm running it through these pipes, and I'm running them through just a little bit of copper radiant pipe to absorb any heat that's going to come off our hydrogen generator. So if we go back to the power over here, hydrogen generator, this guy outputs 4 4,000 duplicate thermal units worth of heat. So I just want to absorb some of that heat with that water if I possibly can before I burn it up with my electrolyzer. And the reason I've used radiant pipes is, if we go to their properties over here, they have a really high thermal conductivity compared to your regular pipes. So your regular pipes only exchange temperature at like a rate of 2.9, whereas your radiant pipes made out of copper are 120, lead they're 70, iron they're 110, and gold they're 120. So lead is one thing you can find on the map fairly easily. Oh, I forgot aluminium. Aluminium is another really, really good choice for radiant pipes. So, you know, you do have a couple of options when it comes to your different radiant pipes. Basically, you want just want something that's going to transfer heat a little bit better. On top of that, I'm taking my polluted water down here, which should have an output temperature of around about 37 degrees after enough runs. And I'm just running it through this section here because, of course, this is where the hot oxygen is going to come out the bottom. And we'll just get a reading at the start. So 28.4 at the start. And after it flows through this loop, it should have hopefully absorbed a little bit of heat, if there is heat. It has. So it's absorbed a little bit of heat. It's gone up to 31 degrees. Where they're going to run it into the water sieve, it's going to sort of split the heat between both our flush system and back into our electrolyzer setup. I could use the clean water and do this loop instead rather than polluted water. It's entirely up to you guys how you want to actually run those two bits of pipe. At the same time, I have been a little bit smarter about my automation. So we had our original automation for our atmo sensor. Again, it's set to, you want to be like 200-300 grams lower pressure than what's out, than what's below the electrolyzer, because as you can see, I keep getting this max gas pressure occasionally. The idea is you want to keep this running as often as possible, but at the same time, you want to make sure that that hydrogen is always staying at the top. So it takes a little bit of fiddling. It's not exactly an exact science. It's going to take a little bit of fiddling to get you a perfect number, but it's a good start for some really, really easy, convenient oxygen for your base. The other part of automation I've actually added to this is my original little tiny battery. We've upgraded it now because we have refined metals. We're a little bit further up that tech tree. We've got a smart battery. Now, this smart battery basically sends a signal to the hydrogen generator to either run or not run if the battery is full. So on this particular power grid, this battery and this hydrogen generator is going to make more than enough power to keep this smart battery running and keep all our devices running. In fact, it's going to have so much, consumption is going to be so low compared to the input, I'm actually going to end up with a situation where I end up with too much hydrogen in this pipe. So I've actually added a second part of automation. So at the moment, can we go to automation? There we go. Okay, so power available, 20,000. This power is at, this battery is at 100%. It's actually said at 80%, turn a red signal on, send a red signal to the actual power generator to turn it off. And at 60% power in the battery, send a green signal to turn that generator back on. As you can see, we're at 100%, well above 80%, and this generator is still running. The reason it's still running is I actually have a second part of automation hooked up to this. So I actually have a gas element sensor. Now, the gas element sensor is sitting on this piece of pipe right here, checking that piece of pipe to say, hey, pipe, do you have hydrogen in there? Because if you do, and this filter gate says, hey, you've had hydrogen in there for at least 5 seconds, we're going to send a green signal into this hydrogen generator to literally burn that hydrogen for the fun of it. We can't have this pipe back up because if it backs up, things are going to break. We end up with too much hydrogen in this pocket, which means there is a chance the hydrogen could start flowing out the bottom and contaminating the rest of our base, or our oxygen production is just going to turn off. So I've added this second little tiny bit of automation up here just to overwrite the first one, say, hey, no matter what, even if the battery is full, run the hydrogen generator because I really do not want my base filling up with hydrogen. As you can see, after that tile's cleared, we go back to the automation. It's flipped back off. Everything's happy. Battery's full. But as I've got a bit more hydrogen in there, we can go back to automation. And you can see, can't see because I can run the game too fast. Come on, empty the pipes. Actually, gas pipe, empty. Done. Okay, we're gonna run that generator real quick. We go to the automation overlay, we're gonna see this is gonna go green, and this is gonna count down for 5 seconds. Once it counts down that 5 seconds, if it's still detecting gas in there, that's when it's gonna send that overriding green signal in and turn on that hydrogen generator, so we don't overdo the gas in the pipes. Obviously, the further down the pipe you can put that sensor, the better, always. I could have snuck it in right here, actually, and give myself a bigger buffer, but, you know, you put it in wherever you want to put it. Anyway, that is my oxygen from P-Build, or P'd oxygen, whichever you want to call it. Either way, when your duplicates pee, you are going to get some free oxygen and some free power out of it. Anyway, that's it for this video. It's a fairly simple build. Hopefully you can pause the video and build it along. If I could give you guys some sort of blueprints in Oxygen Not Included, I would, but even with the mods available, it doesn't quite work yet. So, that's it for this video. As always, if you like the video, click the like button. If you can share it with your friends, I'll very much appreciate it. So will the YouTube algorithm. Same time, if you want to see more tutorials and tips and tricks and all that sort of stuff about Oxygen Not Included, by all means, click the subscribe button. I'll see you guys in the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye.